Hello, everybody. Happy Harloween and welcome back to my channel. We are together. We are, I guess, halfway through the Harloween season. It's raining today. It's so cozy inside. It's just so dark and rainy outside. I'm wearing last year's Harloween shirt with the typewriter, which I love. And I'm just feeling really cozy, except I do have a little bit of a stuffy nose because when it starts raining a lot outside like this and the weather kind of changes drastically, I get a little congested. So that is why I maybe sound a tad bit different, but hopefully you don't notice it that much. So today we're picking up right where we left off in the Missy Bevers case. So if you haven't watched part one yet, you should definitely check the description box where it will be linked and watch that first because one always comes before two. Now, if you recall, the last thing we talked about before closing out part one was the huge scandal of Missy's father-in-law, Randy Bevers, dropping off some dry cleaning, and amongst this dry cleaning was a white woman's shirt with blood on it. Now, after he left, an employee of this dry cleaning business called the police to inform them of this strange development, saying the shirt looked as if somebody had already tried to clean it and that Randy had told them it was animal blood.
Yeah, Doug and Kaylee, according to the search warrant, Midlothian police have seized a woman's white shirt size XXL that Missy Bevers' father-in-law allegedly took to a local dry cleaner just on Friday. This appears to be a copy of that receipt. You can see the description here. It says pullover, animal blood, red, all over white. Now, Randy Bever, as well as his son, just has been in the police station here behind me. They're inside of that police station right now. According to detectives, Randy Bevers took four shirts to the dry cleaner, three shirts described as men's shirts, one XXL women's shirt with blood stains on it on April 22nd.
So I know I am hard on the media, and I call them vultures and all of that. But honestly, given the circumstances and the short amount of time that had passed between when Missy died and when her father-in-law dropped a bloody shirt off at the dry cleaners, I get why they went into full frenzy and why they kind of went into, like, we need to get this story mode. It certainly was suspicious, and everyone already suspected that Brandon had something to do with his wife's death anyway. In order to get ahead of what the Beaver men knew could potentially erupt into a huge rumor with a life of its own, they gave an impromptu press conference outside of the Midlothian Police Department to clear up any miscommunications. They both called it a non-issue, and they explained what really happened, which was that Randy and his wife, Vicky, had been staying with family members since they didn't live in the Midlothian area. They actually lived near Austin, Texas. Now, apparently, Vicky had, you know, this little chihuahua. She and Randy were staying with Brandon's sister, Christy, who had larger dogs. One of Christy's dogs and Vicky's smaller dog got into a fight, resulting sadly in the chihuahua being badly injured, and Vicky scooped up her dog and brought him to the car so they could drive him to a 24-hour animal hospital, which is how the blood got on her shirt, and the dog did not make it, sadly.
Okay, first of all, what happened? What did you in fact drop off some bloody clothes?
Here's the deal. We come in from out of town when we got notified of what had happened. Okay, my wife has a small chihuahua. Okay, she's had for 13 years. It's her baby. Okay, it's just like a child to us. Okay, we've been staying over at a relative's house. Okay, we've been over to his house until late at night. You know, the relative's got two dogs. One of them, they got into a fight. The chihuahua and the big dog got into a fight. The big dog had the chihuahua around the throat. Okay, and when I got the big dog off of it, the chihuahua was laying on the ground, bleeding, you know, scooped up the chihuahua, headed to the animal clinic to see if we could save it. It didn't make it, okay? So carrying the dog from the house to the veterinary clinic, okay, it was bloody, okay? So therefore, blood on the shirt, okay? So the next day, you know, we'd take the shirt and our clothes over to the dry cleaners here in town to, you know, get the blood taken off of it or what they can do. And that's the story.
And I wanted to make sure that we get over here and put this fire out pretty quick.
Because we see the flames going on here, so let's put it out.
This is a, you know, such a non-issue that we wanted to address it fast.
Randy and Brandon Bevers were adamant during the time with the press that they were not offended by the dry cleaners calling the police, because this meant to them that the public was keeping their eyes open and trying to help find Missy's killer, which is what they wanted.
The fact that the person at the dry cleaner had the wherewithal to call the police, that's what we need, that kind of vigilance.
It's
just a sign that people are being diligent about the situation and responding to the police with it. And we want that to continue.
But this was not a suitable explanation for the reporters, who continued to question Randy, asking him, you know, didn't he think it was suspicious to bring a bloody shirt to the dry cleaners days after his daughter-in-law was brutally murdered?
Did you not think it's suspicious to go to the dry cleaners with the bloody shirt? Why not tell the police, hey,
it's a non-issue. It's a non-issue. It's a matter of trying to save a dog's life. Okay, and it's bleeding. Okay, you take it to the veterinarian to try to save its life. It didn't make it. You know, you got blood on it. You're not. You know, and you take it. You know, it's a non-issue. I mean, there's nothing. You know, there shouldn't be anything forethought about trying to take care of that.
Did you think it would look suspicious at all that you show up with a bloody shirt?
Did not come to play. Not when you
show up to a cleaner's to get to and specifically ask them to if you can remove the blood and then give them your name.
Yeah.
I mean. Yeah.
And this did frustrate me a bit, because it's like, he has a bloody shirt. He wants it cleaned. Wouldn't it have been more suspicious if he had not brought it in, almost as if he had something to hide, in a regular, everyday kind of situation when you're innocent and you get a shirt dirty that's dry clean only, you bring it to the dry cleaners. You don't hide it in your closet and wait for the hubbub around your daughter-in-law's death to die down before you bring it in to get it cleaned. So Brandon and Randy told the reporters that the police have collected the shirt and they're testing it for DNA. And surprise, surprise, the DNA results later did come back as dog's blood. RIP to the little chihuahua, but at this point, we aren't any closer to solving the mystery of what happened to Missy. Now, before we continue on with the video, I'd like to have a word from our sponsor, Magellan TV. Magellan TV is a new kind of documentary streaming service created by those who know best what makes a truly compelling and riveting documentary film, filmmakers themselves. I know many of you have already signed up and are currently enjoying all that Magellan TV has to offer, and many of you are planning to try them out as well, or to gift Magellan TV to a family member who really likes documentaries, who really likes learning things. And for you guys, I have a really interesting suggestion on Magellan TV for you to try, and it's called A Shallow Grave. And this film explores the mystery of what happened to a businessman named Alec Steenkamp, who was buried for 8 years in the backyard of a house in Brixton, which is in Johannesburg.
Hundreds of people missing in South Africa. So what makes our case unique? I don't think there is anything other than the fact that the police just never investigated. They never did their job.
Now, Alec was 43 years old when he disappeared after he went to Brixton to collect money from someone, a man named Kenneth Downey. And I don't want to give too much away, but it seems like this investigation was sort of handled poorly from the start, so you should check this film out when you have the chance. If you have Magellan TV or you're planning on trying it out, make sure you give A Shallow Grave a watch. Magellan TV shares your passion for gripping true stories, and they continue to scour the globe for documentaries with the most dramatic imagery, the most cutting-edge subjects, and authentic insights from the world's top historians, scientists, and explorers. They believe that television should be both entertaining and educational, and I agree with them. And that's what makes Magellan TV television worth watching. That's what makes Magellan TV stand out amongst all of the other streaming services out there. They currently have over 2,000 documentary films and series available, and they add more every single week. It's my favorite thing on Monday to go in and check and see what was added that week, what's new to watch, what can I add to my list of things that I want to watch. And Magellan TV is available anytime, anywhere. You can watch on your smartphone, tablet, smart TV, or laptop. You can start a documentary on your smartphone while you're in the shower trying to enjoy your alone time, and you can finish it later on your TV once you're in your pajamas with your hot apple cider or your tea, and you want to finish your cool documentary that you started in the shower and continue your alone time. Magellan TV is offering viewers of this channel the opportunity to explore everything they have to offer with a 1 month free trial. All you have to do is click the link in the description box below and start watching. There are no contracts, no strings attached, and you can cancel anytime you like, but I definitely don't think you're going to want to because there's so much on there for you to watch. There's also so much on there for like the kids to watch with them not really being in school that much lately. I've been trying to find educational things for them to watch that, you know, will keep them actually entertained. And Magellan TV has so much on there that I've been making Aiden watch at first, but he ends up really liking it. Thank you so much to Magellan TV for sponsoring this video, and thank you to all of you out there who watch my videos, who come back every week to watch these videos, and you understand that sponsors are essential to keep this channel going so I can keep bringing you content. Let's dive right back into the video. Okay, so the blood on this white shirt was not human blood, not connected to Missy. However, there are still people out there who believe Brandon's father, Randy, was involved in Missy's death. They say he has a similar body type, he's the right height, or he has a similar walk. But Randy and his wife, Vicky, weren't anywhere near Texas at the time of the murder. They were actually traveling through California in an RV, and they posted a picture of them in Riverside, California, the Sunday before Missy's murder, which was confirmed by a third party, another person who was there with them and took the picture. So Randy could not possibly have done it. He wasn't in Midlothian or even in Texas on that Monday morning. Now, on April 23rd, Missy's funeral was held at their family church, the Cowboy Church.
Photos of bright times in Missy Bevers' life played before a crowd of more than 1,000. There to mourn the 45-year-old mother and fitness instructor murdered inside a Texas church.
It showed what her life represented. She was such a beautiful person, and she was a friend to everybody.
Bevers' students and colleagues wore red, their workout clothes, to honor her. The pastor singled them out during the service, saying they embodied the spirit of Missy.
I wasn't familiar with this church. I'm not from Texas, so I looked it up, and I'll give you the quick breakdown. It seems that the Cowboy Church, they're simply Christian churches within the cowboy culture, and I do remember Brandon talking about how he and his family attended this church, and he said, you know, they certainly didn't consider themselves cowboys or part of, you know, cowboy culture, but they really liked the church, they really liked the people who went to the church, so that's why they attended services there. And I mean, if there's going to be a rodeo instead of an hour-long mass, sign me up too. Like, I will go to the Cowboy Church. The next day, on April 24th, Brandon's mother, Marcia Tucker, posted a public letter to Missy's killer on Marcia's own personal Facebook page, and here's what that message said. Letter to the murderer of Missy Bevers. Do you even realize what you have done to her daughters, husband, our whole family? Was it really worth it? Why did you think this was so necessary? You know who you are. Your husband slash wife and family members know who you are. They know your special walk. Right now, they are as guilty as you are by not coming forward. I honestly pray that you do not have children. My granddaughters at least have the knowledge that their mom was a kind-hearted, loving, caring person. You have now ruined your children's life, along with your family's life, by doing this senseless act. We can at least visit Missy's gravesite, even though we have the comfort of knowing she's already in heaven. Your family will get to visit you in prison, forever reminding you of your crazy, selfish act. What a legacy you have doled out to your family. I will be praying for all of them. I truly feel worse for your family than mine. Please come forward. Give yourself peace. Give our family some peace. Give some honor back to your family. God will forgive you. We will forgive you. Because you know, and we know, that it is what Jesus has commanded us to do. Now, many people believed and speculated after this letter posted that Marcia spoke to this person as if she already knew who it was. So then there was rumors going around that Brandon's family and maybe even Missy's family suspected or knew who her killer was, but I disagree. These are the angry and frustrated words of a person who's lost someone special in their life and feels as if there's no closure. And with no closure, some people feel that there can never be peace. And we do have to remember that Marcia and Missy were very close. Now, the next day, the Midlothian Police Department would issue a warrant that many people felt narrowed down the list of suspects in this case. The warrant requested the cell phone data for the dates of March 1st, 2016 to April 18th, 2016, and they listed 9 people and 11 numbers. So some of these people had more than one phone or more than one number associated to their name. And they referred to these people and these numbers in the warrant as target numbers. Now, probable cause for this warrant was listed as the following reasons. Evidence extracted from Missy and Brandon Beaver's phone provided police officers with 9 potential persons of interest based on the nature of communication between Missy and these target numbers. Midlothian Police Department investigator Cody McKinney, who wrote this warrant, claimed that a portion of these messages, some of which had been deleted, indicated and confirmed an ongoing financial and marital struggle in Missy and Brandon's relationship, as well as intimate slash personal relationship or relationships external to the marriage with the identified target numbers. Now, Cody McKinney goes on to write, quote, "Officers have also received several tips from citizens with possible suspect leads due to surveillance footage being released to the general public. Some of these leads have been very specific as to the approximate height, weight, build, distinct walk, and/or feminine sway of the suspect. These tips have been followed up and identified as the target numbers above," end quote. So basically, the police built this list based off of messages and communications found in Missy's phone, as well as tips from the public. At least that's what the warrant suggests. Now let's go through this list and try to place these people in Missy's life. Number one and number two are Missy and her husband, Brandon. Also on this list are Randy and Vicky Beavers, Brandon's father and his stepmother. But as we know, they were both out of town at the time of the murder and their alibi had been proven. Next, we have a man named AJ Tucker and his wife. Now, AJ was a fellow Camp Gladiator coach. He'd been with Missy in Austin the previous weekend, and after this warrant was made public, he posted to Facebook that people were going through his trash cans at the end of his driveway. These people were apparently driving black Chargers, which is notably a police officer vehicle, so I'm going to assume that they were police officers or law enforcement officials, but this is never explicitly stated anywhere. Now, it makes sense that he might be on this list, but his wife being there does raise some questions. The warrant never says that these numbers contacted or were contacted by Missy frequently, even though that was sort of the general consensus. It only says that the list was compiled after going through Missy's phone, reading her messages both present and deleted. So technically, Missy could have been talking to another party about AJ's wife, maybe saying that AJ's wife was mean to her or she didn't think AJ's wife liked her, and that could have landed AJ's wife on this list. Next, we have a man named Kevin Cosine and his wife, and here's where things get tricky. Kevin seemed to have also been a man who was into fitness. He was a mixed martial arts expert, and it appears that Kevin and his wife had a daughter who was friends with one of Missy's daughters. Now, this is the man that Missy is alleged to have had an affair with, as it was stated in the warrant that there was ongoing marital issues and, you know, outside relationships. And here's where I got stuck, because a rumor of an affair does not necessarily mean there was an affair. So I asked Tim Koval about it when we had our conversation about the case, and he told me pretty much that Missy did in fact have an affair with this man. It was an affair that did become physical. It wasn't just flirtatious texting. And it does seem that Brandon was aware of this, and as a result, he and Missy began going to counseling with the pastor of their church. And this is where I want to rewind and go back to his interview with the press outside of his home, where he said every day for the past 10 months, Missy had made an effort to text him and tell him she loved him and that she hoped he had a good day at work. Here is my theory. Missy has an affair with Kevin Cosine. She either gets caught or confesses to her husband out of guilt, and instead of getting a divorce, Missy and Brandon decide to honor their vows and try to get through this rough patch for better or for worse. They begin to go to therapy so they can, you know, go over the issues that perhaps prompted Missy to be open to having an affair in the first place, and maybe they realized that life's been moving on for both of them while they grew further apart. I believe after the affair and while they were in therapy, Missy began doing this thing with her husband where she would text him every day to say that she loved him. This would be her way of showing that she was serious about making the marriage work and attempting to make contact on a daily basis to touch base, as well as reassuring her husband that she was thinking of him even when they were apart. Now that leads us to our next logical conclusion, which is that Kevin's wife may be on this list of target numbers because she may potentially have a motive to see Missy out of the picture. The strange thing about all of this is that even though Kevin's wife would make the most logical option, so many people after reading this warrant focused on the wife of AJ Tucker. And it's pretty much a hard sell to believe that either AJ or his wife were involved in Missy's murder. First of all, AJ had his own Camp Gladiator class to teach at 5 that morning at a completely different location. Secondly, according to Tim Colville, the Tuckers had 4 young children, one of which was under the age of 1 at that time, very little. So with AJ away teaching his class, it's very difficult to believe that his wife would have left her 4 young children home alone to go out and commit a murder wearing SWAT gear. There was also a rumor that one of Missy's daughters had told someone that Missy was afraid of AJ's wife, but this ended up being false. Tim informed me that Missy did mention feeling uncomfortable around the wife of one of her friends, but he believes this was a couple that lived in Louisiana, and it was less a feeling of fear and more of a personality clash. There's also another name on this list, but it turns out this name was just a female acquaintance of Missy's, and it's worth noting that since this came out, Midlothian police have cleared all of these names, all of these people of interest, essentially saying none of these people were responsible or involved in what happened to Missy. But that does not stop people to this day from attempting to uncover something about these names or about these people that the police have missed, which is fine. You know, think outside the box, pursue every lead. I am completely okay with that as long as we're not going on and like accusing people of being murderers when you have no proof that they are. And that is what has really happened a lot in this case, to the point where it makes me feel very uncomfortable. Now, on April 26th, Cody McKinney filed another warrant. This time, it was an emergency warrant for LinkedIn, the social networking like business application. Now, there's a few different reasons why the police felt it was urgent to get this information from LinkedIn. During their investigation, they had interviewed a friend of Missy's who had been with her in Austin the weekend before her death. And this friend informed the detectives that while they were there, Missy had received a message on LinkedIn that was from a male who was unknown to both of them. And they had both felt that it was a creepy and strange message. This friend could not remember the name of the man. She just remembered when Missy had gotten the message and, you know, that they had talked about it and said it was weird and creepy. Secondly, another person of interest had come to the attention of law enforcement. His name was Casey Williams, and the police discovered that he and Missy had been using LinkedIn to communicate since January of 2016, and this communication continued right up until the time of her death. Using electronic forensic data extraction, it was discovered that the messages between Missy and Casey appeared to be intimate in nature. They were flirty, and they had been deleted after the conversation was over on both Missy and Casey's phones. Now, according to this document, the police had reason to believe that Missy was in contact with several people on LinkedIn, and they wanted to see every message that she had sent or received, even the deleted ones. Now, they were able to retrieve the deleted messages to and from Casey because Casey cooperated and he allowed them to take his phone and retrieve them, and they obviously had Missy's phone as well. But the police would clearly have an interest in discovering who else Missy was talking to, since she most likely would have erased those conversations from her phone as well. So enlisting the help of LinkedIn was their only option. There has never been any kind of follow-up on if they found anything from LinkedIn. There have been a lot of potential leads in this case that we've heard about through the media, but then have never been followed up on. So I don't know if they were dead ends. I don't know if the police did find something. They just didn't reveal it. It's a very, like I said at the beginning of, you know, part one, a very closed off sort of investigation with a lot of question marks, a lot of questions that don't have any answers. And aside from small things here or there, what I just told you has been the extent of the investigation. And even though it doesn't seem like police did a whole lot, if you think about it, if you think about what they had to go on, what they had to start with, they did the best they could, really. You've got a suspect who you cannot identify. The police requested all the records and all the information. They checked alibis. They questioned people. But at the end of the day, when you run out of leads, what can you really do? And that brings me back to the surveillance footage from the SWFA parking lot. Now, the overall opinion on this video and its connection to Missy is pretty evenly split. You have people who do not believe that it's connected at all, and you have people who think it is connected. I'm one of the people who do believe that it's connected. Now, it appears that the SWFA store had 17 cameras mounted outside, and they were able to capture this vehicle's entire stay in their parking lot. The entire video is just under 8 minutes, and the car was identified as some sort of light-colored Nissan four-door sedan, which was initially described as having an oval bumper sticker on the back bumper, compelling thousands of people on the internet to put on their Sherlock hats and attempt to identify what the bumper sticker could be. Now, in reality, there is no bumper sticker on that car, as Tim Koval points out in his blog, where he talks about the myths in this case. It is simply a reflection of the oval SWFA sign mounted on the building. So right there, we have this false lead, this sort of false information. However, police have publicly stated they do not believe this vehicle was connected to Missy. They just wanted the driver to come forward, hoping that this person might have some information or could clear themselves of any involvement in the case. But here's the thing. No one ever came forward admitting to having been the one in that car, in that parking lot at 2 a.m. the same morning Missy Bevers would be murdered just down the street. And that is suspicious to me. I've also heard some people say that if this driver was trying to hide their identity, they would not have parked directly under the parking lot light. They would have found a dark corner of the parking lot to hide out in, and I disagree. It was dark, it was rainy, and parking underneath that light would have cast such a strong reflection on the windshield of the car, which we can see it did in the video, it would be pretty much impossible to see inside. Now, if this person driving the car had parked further away from the light, the police may have been able to use enhancement technology to identify them. If they had parked with the front of the car, facing away from the cameras, the license plate would have been visible to the cameras. Parking under this huge overhead light with the front of the car facing the surveillance cameras was actually the best way, in my opinion, to keep the identity of the driver as well as the license plate hidden. And logically, we can ask ourselves, what would be the reason to pull into the parking lot of a closed business at 2 o'clock in the morning and stay there for, you know, under 10 minutes, being parked for roughly 3 of those minutes? Why turn off the headlights as soon as you pull in? Why do this weird thing where you slow down and flash your headlights? The fact that no one ever came forward admitting to having been in that car, coupled with the bizarre behavior of the car while it was in the parking lot, makes me think that it is in fact connected to what happened to Missy. This could have been the perpetrator themselves, pulling in after breaking some windows at the church and watching to see if the police showed up. Or maybe they had a police scanner or an app that allows you to listen to the police channel and hear what calls are coming in. I have one. It's very easy to use. Maybe the person in the Nissan was helping the person in the SWAT gear who was nearby. After all these warrants, I really highly doubt either of these individuals had a cell phone connected to the internet on them. But they could have been using walkie-talkies. You can buy a pair of walkie-talkies on Amazon for $50 that allows you to communicate within a few mile radius. Maybe the driver of the Nissan and the suspect at the church were testing this out so they would know exactly how far the getaway car could be from the church before the walkies didn't work anymore. And actually, just thinking about this right now, when I said, you know, I doubt they had a cell phone connected to the internet, it popped something into my head. I'm sure that the SWFA gun store had Wi-Fi. So what if this person had a tablet or, you know, a phone that wasn't connected to like 4G, and they had previously gone into the gun store and connected to the gun store's Wi-Fi or the SWFA store? It's not technically a gun store. What if they'd gone into the SWFA previously as if they were a customer, connected to the store's Wi-Fi, and they pulled into the parking lot to reconnect to the store's Wi-Fi to send a message or to, you know, pull up a police scanning app or something like that. That's also possible. So I would definitely have checked if I was the police, if anybody had hooked up to the Wi-Fi of that SWFA store on that morning, to see maybe if they could track somebody down that way. I'm not sure if they did that or not. Because it's also suspicious that the police requested these cell phone records for everyone in the area on the date of the murder in that time period, and they apparently have never found the driver of this car, meaning the driver of this car didn't have a cell phone on them that was connected to the internet. And most people, even in 2016, did not drive around without their cell phones unless they are trying to purposely stay off the grid. Now let's move on to the theories portion of this case, and we've already pretty much ruled out many of the most obvious ones. I personally do not believe her husband was involved with her murder. He was out of town, and I have to feel that if he had somehow dealt with a third party to set up a hit, as some people suggest, the police would have figured that out when they got their hands on his phones. He had two phones, a personal phone and a work phone. It is possible that he was involved and he did somehow contact someone and arrange for them to take his wife out. I mean, of course it is. It's always possible because we don't know what happened in the case. But I do believe he would have had to pay something, right, for such a service. I don't think that most hitmen do these things for free. And I imagine that his financials were looked through with a fine-tooth comb. I mean, there's still people who believe Brandon had something to do with it. And if you're one of those people, I completely understand. Let me know in the comments. We can talk about it. And, you know, we can go over these things, but I personally do not. But it's okay if you disagree with me. I don't hate you for disagreeing with me. Now, we also have those people on the target list of numbers. Although there's a lot of sticky situations, awkward relationships involved, all of them were cleared by the police, meaning their alibis checked out. So what does that leave us with? Could this have been a robbery gone wrong? The suspect entered the church very early on a Monday morning, and if this was a random money grab done by someone who didn't know Missy at all, they most likely would not guess or imagine that someone would be in that church that early. And if you are going to rob a church, early Monday morning is as good a time as any, I suppose. The best time, you might say. Money's collected during church services on Sunday, and it would be placed somewhere safe in the church until it could be deposited in the bank Monday morning. So between Sunday services and Monday morning when the bank's open would be the best time to rob a church if you were going to. And it's possible that this person could have been looking for the money taken in through the collection plate. Additionally, although Midlothian is a small town, it's not necessarily a remote town. Both the church and the outdoor store, the SWFA outdoor store, are located on Highway 287, which at 1,791 miles long, it makes it the longest three-digit highway in the U.S., its southern terminus is in Port Arthur, Texas, and if you travel all the way down, you'll go through several states before ending up in Montana, just 100 miles away from the Canadian border. This is a highway that's popular for truckers to use when hauling their goods, doing their trucker stuff. It's not out of the question that Missy's killer could have been from anywhere in the world, just traveling through. That being said, I still think she was the target. Because a crime like this would take a lot of planning. Very few people have this kind of gear just laying around their home, you know, this tactical SWAT gear, just laying around their home. And even fewer travel with it in their vehicles at all time, I would imagine. So I'd imagine that person planned to be at the church at this time with these clothing items. Now, we know that the perpetrator seems to have broken other windows in the church that they never used for entry. This shows forethought and planning. Someone made sure they collected this mishmash of clothing so that they would be covered from head to toe and unidentifiable. They made sure to go there on that day early enough to break some windows and see if anyone showed up to investigate. They showed up on camera about 25 minutes before Missy was due to arrive, and when they killed her, they left. Nothing was missing, nothing was taken, and in fact, there was actually very little damage done to the inside of the church, even though news articles will make you think otherwise, and they'll make you think that this person came in and just started destroying everything. And remember, This whole time, we have thought that Missy was beaten to death in some way, because all these news articles, they say she was bludgeoned to death. All these news reports say she was bludgeoned to death with one of these instruments that the suspect was seen with on surveillance. Why do we think that she was bludgeoned to death? Well, because even though the police never verbally stated her cause of death, the related warrants said there were several puncture wounds to her head and chest caused by an instrument the suspect was carrying. So we did get this information, in a way, from the Midlothian Police Department and then by proxy from the media. But Missy Bevers was not hit over the head with something or stabbed with something. She was shot. Another YouTuber named Nikki Mick illustrates on her channel how she was able to access FBI data uploaded to murderdata.com, and it shows that the weapon used in Missy's murder was actually a handgun, pistol, or revolver. There's also an Ellis County CSI report that states on April 20th, an e-trace search with the ATF was done on the handgun found at the body site location. This document goes on to say that a woman named Penny Rowley with the Walmart loss prevention team was spoken to, and she was requested to do a search with Walmarts in the surrounding areas for suspicious sales of ammunition and or guns in the early morning hours of April 18th, 2016, the day Missy died. So Missy was actually shot, and the murder weapon appears to have been left behind by the suspect, which is very strange because there have really been no official media reports saying that she was shot, and the police have never really confirmed that. Why are they holding so much so close to the vest? There's also the fact that the manager of Missy's gym spoke with Nancy Grace after the murder and indicated that Missy had been behaving differently in the weeks leading up to her death.
She seemed a little more reserved.
Mark Garcia works at a gym where Bevers used to work out. He says that in recent weeks, the 45-year-old didn't seem like herself.
I don't think she was at the wrong place at the wrong time. I feel like someone was after her.
He said that Missy would come in several times a week to work out. She knew the staff by name. She knew many of the other gym members by name. She was always there, but suddenly she just stopped going to the gym altogether. Was someone affiliated with her gym harassing her, bothering her, or scaring her? Was somebody else who went to that gym bothering her, harassing her, scaring her? We don't know. So putting the random robbery theory aside, we need to examine the theory that it was someone who knew her, someone who was in Missy's life. And that brings me to our next suspect, a man named Bobby Wayne Henry. And this guy's a piece of work. I need to get my coffee before I continue talking about him. I need reinforcements. I'll be right back. Okay, so I got my coffee, and now let's talk about Bobby Wayne Henry and all my reasons of why he has been my main suspect for a while. Besides Exhibit A, which he has a serial killer name. Bobby Wayne Henry is a legit serial killer name like I've never heard. But there's so much else about this guy, and it's hard to figure out where to start. But in the interest of not leaving anything out, I'm going to start from the beginning. And most of this information was garnered from a dossier that Tim Koval put together after doing his own digging, as well as speaking to several people in Bobby's life, including his childhood friend, Doyle Judkins. Now, let me say before we continue, the following information is alleged, even though much of it is public information. Even though much of it was gathered from actual people who knew this man, it's still alleged because I'm not trying to get sued, and rumor has it, Bobby Wayne Henry loves threatening to sue people who talk about him. So we're gonna say, disclaimer, it's all alleged, okay? We're just talking here. I'm just talking to you guys about a man who is very suspicious to me and who I allegedly think could have been involved in Missy's death and who I allegedly think is a scumbag even if he wasn't and should be talked about on a true crime video. So let's dive right in to Bobby Wayne Henry. Bobby Wayne Henry was born and raised in the Dallas, Texas area, where he lived with his father Robert, his mother Joyce, and his sister Susan, who was developmentally disabled. At some point during his early childhood, Bobby's parents divorced and his father remarried a woman named Sue Akin when Bobby was 8 years old. In junior high, Bobby met and befriended Doyle Judkins, And according to Doyle, they were very close, more like brothers than friends. Now, from what I can tell, Bobby's parents divorced. His mother moved out with his sister Susan, and Bobby stayed with his father. But his mother and sister were nearby, and he could spend time with them as well. And according to Doyle, Bobby claimed that he had once witnessed his sister being sexually assaulted, and he had stepped in and saved the day and saved her from being assaulted. Now, the odd thing is, it didn't seem that his sister Susan left the house all that much. According to Doyle, she was always home. She didn't seem to attend their school or any school. And Bobby's mother would sometimes ask Bobby to stay with Susan to keep an eye on her. So where this alleged assault took place, who was the alleged assailant, we can't be sure. Chances are it never happened because, as we will come to find, Bobby's a master of telling tall tales. There's even a chance, allegedly, that he may have been inappropriate with his own sister, as Doyle felt there was always something off in Bobby's relationship with his sister. And this may seem like a stretch to you right now, but as more of Bobby's story unfolds, you'll see why it could be possible, especially with his sister, because Bobby seemed to like having control over people, seemed to like dominating people. And when I say people, I mean women. Once again, I am not saying or accusing Bobby of anything. I'm not saying he did anything to his sister. I'm saying, given that she was developmentally disabled, given that they were often alone together, and given that I believe he created this sexual assault story that was never corroborated by anyone else, also given that he has a pattern of forcing himself on women, a pattern that can be seen in court and police documents, which are public records, that just makes me think it could be a possibility. We're just spitballing here, okay? In high school, Doyle remembers that Bobby would often skip school to go to house parties where there would be drinking. Now, Doyle did not attend these parties, so he only has second information about what happened at them, but he was told that Bobby had an issue with the ladies, maybe a hearing problem, like a loss of hearing when it came to what they wanted and what they didn't want. Doyle told Tim Koval, quote, "He was being weird, wouldn't take no for an answer. Some of the guys had to get on him," end quote. Now, apparently, Bobby would make advances at certain young ladies who had told him no, certain young ladies who had been escorted to these parties by boyfriends or dates, and then these boyfriends and dates would have to intervene. As far as any girlfriends in high school, Doyle doesn't think Bobby dedicated his charms to just one lucky girl. Doyle doesn't remember Bobby going on any actual dates or walking any girls to school or sitting with any girls at lunch. Now, as high school neared to its end, Bobby enlisted in the Navy and Doyle enlisted into the Marines. But this wasn't the end of their interactions. They were still friends, they were close, and at some point over the next year, Doyle married a woman named Pam. So Bobby and Doyle are both home on military leave for the holidays. They kind of have a bond, they're friends, they're like brothers, and Doyle's wife, Pam, had introduced Bobby to her sister, Bonnie. And Bobby and Bonnie were now together. So it was just kind of one big family affair. It's January 2nd, 1982, and they decide to go rabbit hunting in Wilmer off of Wintergreen Road, something they'd done before without incident. So they're out there hunting rabbits for a while. Bobby hasn't caught anything. Doyle's caught like two or three rabbits, and they decide to call it a day and head back to the car, which was parked at the road. Now, as they're walking down the hill towards the car, apparently Bobby saw a rabbit that happened to be right next to Doyle. Because the next thing you know, Doyle's left leg was shot nearly clean off. Now, let me remind you, okay, Bobby grew up in Texas. He hunted. He was in the military. He certainly knew how to use a gun, but somehow he managed to confuse his best friend for a rabbit or to miss this invisible, quickly jumping rabbit that Doyle never saw and hit his best friend in the leg instead. Of course, I'm not saying he did it on purpose. I'm just saying it's odd. So Bobby gets Doyle back to the car, puts him in the back seat, and Doyle is like wrapping a shirt around his leg in an attempt to stop the bleeding. And Doyle told Bobby, look, get it started and just go to the first house and call 911. Doyle knew how much blood he was losing. He knew he probably wouldn't make it to the hospital, but Bobby did not get the car started, right? Doyle claims that he could smell the gasoline and hear like the engine sort of churning. Bobby was flooding the engine over and over again. So finally, Doyle told him, if you can't get it started, you better start running because I need help. Now, Bobby did get out of the car and start running, but instead of running towards the road, which would be, you know, the logical thing to do, find a house or another car that could bring you to a phone, Bobby ran into this big field, and eventually he did find a guy, a farmer, on his tractor, and the guy was like, yeah, I mean, you can use my phone, but I don't have a phone, in the middle of a field in 1982. Obviously, the phone, it's a house phone, it's up at the house. Now, Doyle felt this whole field excursion was a waste of time, and I tend to agree with him. Now, by the time Doyle got to the emergency room, he had no pulse, he had lost all of the blood in his body except for one pint, and he was pronounced dead on arrival. Fortunately, they were able to use, you know, the paddles and get him back, but this accident, allegedly, changed his life forever. His entire knee had been blown out. There was pretty much no knee left, and they had to fuse his left leg together, removing all the tissue that had been irreparably damaged, which left his left leg 4 inches shorter than his right leg. He would have to wear boot lifts to compensate for the difference, but whenever he was shoeless, he would get these horrible backaches and headaches, so eventually he just decided it would make his life easier if his legs were the same length, and he had his right leg shortened as well to kind of match his left leg. To say the least, it was an inconvenient accident. He pretty much was in pain for a long time. It ended his career in the Marine Corps, and I can imagine that it was very mentally troubling as well. Now, at the time, Doyle had thought it was a genuine accident. Bobby had seemed truly troubled and shocked, but as time went on, Doyle began to change his mind. About a year and a half after the shooting, Bobby was discharged from the Navy. We don't know exactly why. We don't know if it was an honorable discharge or a dishonorable discharge, and those records seem to be sealed until his death, so who knows when we'll ever know. But Bobby landed on his feet going into a law enforcement career. He became a police officer, and here's where I want to introduce the fact that Bobby Wayne Henry is a compulsive liar. Allegedly. He would tell people that he was a Navy SEAL, but Doyle says this cannot be true. In his interview with Tim Koval, Doyle claimed that Bobby could not pass the psych exam to enter the Marine Corps, so he doubts that the Navy SEALs would have taken him, and besides, Bobby's military career wasn't really long enough to achieve SEAL status. Bobby also told people that while he was in the Navy SEALs, he and his secret girlfriend, who apparently was part of the Canadian secret military, they'd be sent on these super like covert missions to South America. Later, when he was a police officer, this story would slightly change. He still had this secret girlfriend, but she was no longer in the Canadian military. She was another police officer, and they would go on these super secret undercover police operations together. Now, in both versions of this story, this fabricated girlfriend ended up tragically dying. Now, while Bobby was a police officer with the Wilmer PD, he would constantly tell his friend Doyle all of these just unbelievable stories, these tall tales, these stories where he, Bobby, was always the hero, saving the day. One day he told Doyle that he had pulled a wanted serial killer over during a routine traffic stop, and using his sharp wit and fast thinking, Bobby was able to arrest this guy and get him behind bars. Now, Doyle did not believe Bobby, and he told him so, saying, quote, dude, if that were true, that shit would have been on the news, end quote. But Bobby had an explanation for that, too. They were trying to keep it real hush-hush, because if the killer's friends knew where he was, they would try to get him out, because so many serial killers run in packs, and they just have this whole, like, Avengers team waiting in the wings with their capes on, ready to bust them out of jail. So basically, eerily similar in the way that Michael Turney views himself as this, like, action hero, Bobby Wayne Henry is the star of his own movie, and he's the writer, director, and producer as well. And it really does, it reminds me of Michael Turney, and if you don't remember the case or you haven't seen my videos on the Alyssa Turney case, Michael Turney and Bobby Wayne Henry, they could be brothers. All right, so now back to Bobby's timeline. We're in the late 1980s. Bobby's a police officer, and Bobby's father is still married to this woman, Sue Aiken. Now, according to Sue, During this time frame, her stepson, Bobby, came over to the house she was sharing with his father while she was there alone and sexually assaulted her twice, using handcuffs and brandishing a gun. Now, allegedly, at the time of these assaults, she did not press charges in exchange for being able to leave the marriage with Bobby's father and get everything she wanted in the divorce. We also have to remember that this was the 80s, and a lot of times sexual assaults did go unreported due to the victim fearing stigma or retribution. We also have to remember that Bobby was a police officer, so it's very likely in this time and place, Sue would have been judged. She would have been not believed, or the whole thing would have gotten brushed under the rug due to his law enforcement ties. So for you victim blamers out there who will use her initial inaction as a way to cast doubt on her story, shush up. Sue would, however, give her testimony during the hearing of another one of Bobby's alleged victims in 1996, a woman named Pam. Now, this is the same Pam who previously had been married to Bobby's childhood friend, Doyle, and the same Pam who was the sister of Bobby's wife, Bonnie. In 1996, Pam was divorced from Doyle and had remarried, and Bobby had also just walked out on his own wife, Bonnie, in 1996. He showed up at Pam's house. So remember, this was not only the ex-wife of his closest friend, but technically his sister-in-law. Bobby told Pam he needed a friendly ear to listen to his problems, but once she let him inside, he became aggressive. He forced her to put on this red lingerie that he had brought with him. He made her pose in suggestive ways, and he took pictures of her using a Polaroid camera. He bent her over the couch, put a gun to her head, and sexually assaulted her, according to Pam. And afterwards, he threatened that if she ever told anyone, he would make the pictures he had taken of her public. After he left, Pam called the police and filed charges. At some point between when she reported him and his trial, roughly a year later, someone left something in Pam's mailbox. It was a page ripped from a magazine showing a woman dressed in red lingerie posing in exactly the same way Bobby had forced Pam to pose. In my opinion, this was a threat that said, "Remember, I have these pictures of you. Maybe you should suddenly suffer from memory loss and forget what it was that I did to you." Allegedly, I'm just saying, it looks like a threat to me. Pam turned this evidence over to the police. The trial ended up happening in 1997, and it seems that Bobby's father had hired Bobby some of the best lawyers in the area who were known to get their clients' results. Husband and wife team Kent and Connie McGuire, and they did their worst in the courtroom defending Bobby, like their worst in the best way for Bobby. They accused everyone who took the stand of lying for their own benefit, including Doyle, who testified on the behalf of his ex-wife Pam. They tried to suggest that the only reason Doyle was testifying was because he owed back child support and he was essentially only helping Pam because she'd promised to forgive the debt. Now, according to Doyle and Pam, that allegation was ridiculous since he'd never fallen behind on his child support. And he was genuinely shocked when he heard what had happened to Sue and wanted to see justice done. This incident with his ex-wife Sue only reinforced Doyle's belief that Bobby had shot him on purpose that day, over a decade prior. Maybe he'd always had a thing for Sue and wanted Doyle out of the way. Maybe he'd only married Bonnie, Sue's sister, who had introduced Bobby to Bonnie, to stay close to Sue or to get closer to Sue. We have documentation that this trial happened. We can see the two photographs featuring a red negligee were introduced as evidence, as well as two audio tapes. And it says that Bobby was facing a discharge from the Lancaster Police Department if found guilty of these charges. Turns out that the jury felt Bobby's lawyer did raise enough reasonable doubt, and the trial resulted in an acquittal after the jury told the judge they were initially deadlocked. So Bobby goes on with his life, continues to be a police officer, continues to be allowed to carry a firearm, and he gets married again to a woman named Pam Krause. They have one child together, Bobby's only biological child, but Pam divorces him a few years later when she claims she came home to find him sitting in front of a computer, naked and using a webcam. Apparently, Pam had no idea they'd even had an internet connection in their home, something else that he had kept from her, that the fact that he'd set up this internet connection. So when she comes home and she discovers this gruesome scene, Pam makes Bobby promise to cancel the internet service. She doesn't want it in her house. She doesn't want him to be tempted with this. But later that same night, he gave her a letter that he claimed was from his chief of police, saying that Bobby needed to have the internet in order to do his job, And Pam Krause believes that this was a fake letter, so that's when she decided to divorce him, you know, for good. In 2003, Bobby was dating another woman named Missy, not Missy Bevers, another woman named Missy, and her name is spelled with an I instead of a Y. At this point, Bobby had been divorced from Pam Krause for roughly a year and a half, but Pam's mother, Beverly, starts getting these creepy late-night phone calls that would always happen at either 2 or 5 in the morning. And there was always a man on the other end of the line who was disguising his voice, but would tell her these disgusting, creepy things like he wanted to overpower her, he wanted to dominate her. According to Beverly, all but one of these calls were from blocked numbers. And the one that wasn't blocked read City of Lancaster on the caller ID. Now, Bobby worked overnights for the police department, and calling from the station would have resulted in the caller ID reading City of Lancaster. So it is the theory, allegedly, that it was Bobby calling and that he just forgot to block one of these calls since he was making so many. Beverly also claimed that the suspect on the phone said something that Bobby himself would often say. Now, apparently, when these calls had first started coming in, Beverly talked to Bobby about them because he was her ex-son-in-law and he was also a police officer. So, you know, she thought maybe he could help. But one night, Beverly heard a knock on her door. She opened the door only to find that there was no one on the other side. As she's kind of sitting there looking around like, who knocked on my door? You know, she claims that Bobby, like, stepped out of the shadows, which startled her. And he told her he was there in reference to the calls she'd been getting, the late night creepy phone calls, claiming that there was other people in the area receiving them as well. And he wanted to know if he could come in and talk to her about them. She said yes. He comes in the house, and then Bobby asked Beverly if she still had a gun. And she's like, yeah, I still have a gun. And he's like, well, show me where it is. So Beverly leads him into her bedroom. She goes to the closet and takes out the gun, only to turn and find Bobby standing directly behind her, like pressed into her. He took the gun out of her hand and he held it to her head and started to attempt to sexually assault her. Now, according to Beverly, she began to question him, you know, what are you doing? Like, what's going on? And he told her he was feeling depressed because he'd just been fired from a job after only working there for 1 month. It turned out that Bobby did have a job on the side outside of the police department. It was with a company called Fabricon, and allegedly during his interview with this company, he had told the owner or the manager, whoever interviewed him, that he had the skills needed to do this job. But after he was hired, it became very clear to everyone that he did not have the skills. He didn't know what he was doing, so they had to let him go. And this upset him. Now, during this attempted assault, Beverly starts talking to Bobby about, you know, his daughter and her granddaughter, Grace, and saying, you know, think about Grace, think about your daughter. And according to her, Bobby started crying and he stopped. And Beverly was like, you know, you need to go get some help. Like, if you're this depressed, you need to go get some help. But Bobby did not go get help. In fact, he acted like it had never happened. So Beverly called the police and reported him. There is once again a criminal case against him. He claims he was never even there that evening, but during the investigation, his cell phone data gave him up as his phone pinged at Beverly's house. But Bobby did not go to prison for this. He didn't serve time for this. As far as I can tell, this was not a full-blown sexual assault that resulted in, you know, a rape. Even though, in my opinion, that shouldn't matter. It shouldn't be different. The law does look at them differently, I guess. Bobby agreed in this case to deferred adjudication, which is when a defendant pleads guilty or no contest to criminal charges in exchange for meeting certain requirements laid out by the court. And in Bobby's case, these requirements were that he had to give up his police officer license, he had to go to counseling, and he had to donate money to charity. So he can't be a police officer anymore. Finally, it's about time. I don't know why it would take so long, but he still gets to keep his license to carry a firearm, and he starts working security. He's also still dating this woman named Missy, who he'd been lying to and, you know, kind of telling her that he was already divorced from his previous wife, which he wasn't yet, but she still got married to him after the divorce was final. Bobby did take some random jobs working security at the Marriott in Dallas, Texas, which he was fired from unknown reasons. He did some carpet cleaning for a little bit, and then in 2014, he began working as a security guard at the Arlington Hospital. Now, in 2016, Bobby no longer works at the hospital, but he has different stories of why he no longer works at the hospital. One story has him being fired for, once again, being the hero of his own movie, breaking up a domestic fight and getting a little too rough, you know, with the guy who was in this domestic fight. And so he got fired for that because he's just a good guy doing good things and nobody can see that, you know. It's so frustrating to be Bobby. Anyways, the other story he tells is that he quit because he and Missy, his wife, had just adopted a baby and he wanted to be home to help out with the baby and spend more time with the baby. And you heard that right. Someone allowed this man to adopt a newborn baby with his criminal record. Someone let that happen. That really happened. And this brings us right up to the year 2016, the year that Missy Bevers was murdered. It's a little unclear as to how exactly Bobby Wayne Henry got himself on Midlothian PD's radar, but it seems like he worked security at the church that he attended, the Avenue Church. And when the Creekside Church, where Missy was murdered, put on a memorial service for her 2 days after her death, they contacted the Avenue Church and asked if they could borrow a few members of their security team. One of these security team members was Bobby. Now, I think this guy is a complete scumbag, but I still want to be fair. It's often reported that Bobby volunteered and insisted that he work security at Missy's funeral, even though he also claimed he'd never met Missy and didn't know anyone in her family. And he was not actually present at her actual funeral. He only worked security at the memorial service, and he claims he was enlisted to do so, that it was not his idea. However, at the memorial service, while Bobby's doing his security stuff, he's captured on camera walking around the parking lot. And I'm going to play you this video, and I'm going to tell you that the similarities between Bobby's walk and the walk of the suspect in the Creekside Church who took Missy's life are striking. Shocking, in fact. So I believe once this video started circulating, people began calling in tips about Bobby to the Midlothian Police Department, which prompted them to call him in for an interview on May 6th, 2016. Bobby admits that he was ex-military, he was ex-law enforcement, and he did have tactical gear like the suspect was seen wearing in the surveillance footage, but it no longer fit him. I think he said it was too small for him. And besides, Bobby had an ironclad alibi. He was home at 3 a.m. on the morning Missy was killed, feeding this newborn baby while his wife, Missy, got ready for work. Now, obviously, I was being sarcastic when I said he had an ironclad alibi, since his alibi is a baby who can't talk and his wife who can't be compelled to testify against him in a court of law anyways, and also might have an interest in not seeing her husband go to prison, but that's just alleged. Allegedly. The following December, Midlothian police executed a search warrant at the home of Bobby Wayne Henry in Ennis, Texas. Now, remember, and I don't know if I'm going to say remember, and I actually brought this up before, so I'm just going to reiterate. There had been an eyewitness the morning that Missy died who had seen a dark-colored, small SUV leaving the parking lot of the Creekside Church. So there's this probable cause affidavit that's giving the reasons that the police think it's valid they search Bobby's home. And in it, we can read that the police received multiple tips of people that could possibly be involved in Missy's death. And one name was repeated over and over again, Bobby Wayne Henry. The affidavit said that Bobby had a similar body type slash build as the suspect. He had a similar walk or gait. And he had worked prior in law enforcement and as a tactical officer. Now, here's the thing. As much as I wanted to be fair previous to this, this affidavit does state that Bobby volunteered to work Missy's memorial service. And since Bobby has a history of making everything up, it's kind of tough to distinguish who's telling the truth. But I think it might not be Bobby. I think it might not be him. I know it's crazy, but I have an inkling, like I have to go with my gut. So the affidavit also says that investigators had received information from a passerby on the morning of April 18th, and this is the eyewitness who saw a dark-colored small sport utility vehicle leaving the Creekside parking lot at approximately 4:30 a.m. Investigators were able to confirm that Bobby owned and operated a dark brown 2014 Honda CR-V. Bobby also told officers that he owned a helmet similar to the one that the suspect was wearing in the video, as well as a tactical vest with the word police on the front and back, but it didn't fit him any longer. But we do have to keep in mind that he did own that gear, so he could have lent it out to somebody. He could be involved, even if it wasn't him. This document also claims that Bobby worked at and attended the same church as Missy and her family attended, the Cowboy Church, but once again, later Bobby did deny this, so I'm honestly not sure if it's true or not. I can't find any proof or evidence that Bobby attended the Cowboy Church, which is the church that Missy and her family attended. I can't find that anywhere, so I will give him the benefit of the doubt. However, a podiatrist with over 25 years of experience reviewed the footage, both of the suspect walking around the church in the surveillance video and of Bobby walking around the parking lot at Missy's memorial service. This forensic podiatrist said he could not rule out or exclude that it was Bobby based on the video comparison footage, and he said that they could very well be the same person. Over the course of the investigation, law enforcement officers had conducted video surveillance of other identified persons of interest who possibly exhibited a similar gait or walk, and this footage was also sent to the forensic podiatrist, who was able to rule out all persons of interest besides Bobby Wayne Henry. Now, what the police were looking for when they went into his home on the search warrant was tactical or police-style gear, pry tools such as crowbars or hammers, weapons utilized by the suspect in the Creekside Church surveillance footage, as well as electronic and wireless devices such as computers, tablets, phones, etc. What they ended up finding was shocking, to say the least. So they did go into his house, they did remove several items, and they didn't really find anything that tied Bobby to Missy's murder. But they took, you know, the computers and the electronic devices anyways to process them and analyze their contents. And on his computer, they found what I'm going to call CP pictures. And hopefully you know what that means, because it stands for something that YouTube will not let me say. Now, while that's simmering in your head, remember also that this same man had just adopted and was in custody and caring for a newborn baby. So there's that. Bobby's arrested because of the stuff found on his computer, and he ends up spending over 70 days in jail, but then in September of 2017, a grand jury no-bills the charge. And this means that a formal document was filed with the court letting the defendant know, and the defendant's attorney know, and the judge, and, you know, the clerk, letting all these people know that they weren't going to be pressing charges against Bobby. This doesn't necessarily mean that they can't press charges against him in the future for this, but as of at that point, they're not pressing charges. Apparently, what happened here is Bobby claimed he had not been in possession of that particular computer the whole time he'd owned it. He said he'd owned it, and then he gave it to his daughter to use, and his daughter's cousin. And so basically he was trying to say, like, anybody could have put that stuff there. You can't prove it was me, essentially, right? Now, at this time, his daughter, who was allegedly using the computer to look up these pictures and download these pictures, she was 12. And after she used it, he'd taken it back, telling her that it was broken, and he continued to use it himself for several years after that, allegedly. And apparently this was enough reasonable doubt to not charge him for what was found on that computer, and to allow him to keep custody of this poor, innocent baby he had adopted, because our justice system is broken, guys. Our justice system is broken when it comes to sexual assaults, when it comes to child abuse, when it comes to spousal abuse, when it comes to things like this with the CP on the computer. Our justice system is broken. So many people do believe that Bobby Wayne Henry is the person who killed Missy Bevers. And there's a lot in his past that suggests, you know, he might have. It might have been a pattern for him. It seemed that many of Bobby's previous attacks were triggered by moments of a loss in his life. Specifically, the loss of a job. Right before he attacked his mother-in-law, he'd lost a job. Right before Missy's attack, he'd lost a job. This is a pattern that we cannot ignore, as well as his access to tactical gear, his pointless alibi that means absolutely nothing, the way he walks that's eerily similar to the way the suspect walked in that surveillance footage. And just the fact that he is all around a shitty person who likes to control and dominate women and make them do what he wants at gunpoint, allegedly. But Missy was strong. Missy was a fighter. Missy was a gladiator. Missy also had some self-defense training. And could it be that if Bobby was the one who attacked her, he kind of underestimated her strength? If she'd fought back when he tried to attack her, he may have decided it was just too much work, and out of anger and frustration, he killed her in order to experience some level of power. We know now that she was shot, and we know that Bobby likes to bring guns to his dates, right? However, to look at it from another angle, Brandon Bevers was interviewed by Fox 4 on May 24th, and he claimed that he was able to view more of the surveillance video that had not been released to the public, and he was over 100% sure that the suspect on that footage was, in fact, a woman, not a man. So where does that leave us? A scorned wife? A jealous friend? What woman in Missy's life would want to kill her? This is a very popular theory that the person in this video is not a man at all, but a female. The way this person walks, if it was a woman, could suggest that she was wearing borrowed or stolen clothes and gear that was much too large for her, including the boots, which would cause her to walk differently than she normally would. I mean, think about it. Like, when my little daughter tries on a pair of my shoes, she walks duck-footed with her feet pointed outward in an attempt to keep the shoes on her little feet. Missy suspected to have been in contact with many different men, and some of these men did have wives. Wives who may not have been happy about their husband's communication with Missy. And to add more layers to this already mysterious case, because it is Harloween, Missy was killed in a church, entering at approximately 4:18 on April 18th, or 4:18. We know she was religious. We know how many people in her circle were also religious. And Jeremiah 4:18 reads, "Your ways and your deeds have brought this upon you. The punishment is bitter, piercing you to the heart." This attack, in my opinion, was clearly planned for a specific time and date and intended for Missy. Someone made sure they had the gear. Someone took care to not trigger alarms. Someone lay in wait for her to enter that church. They killed her and then they vanished into the night. They still have not been found. I stand by my original thought that this was not some random wrong place, wrong time tragedy. Missy was targeted. Was someone trying to tell her that she'd brought this upon herself by picking this day, this time, this place? Was someone trying to use her religious beliefs against her to paint her as a hypocrite? I'm not sure. It could be a coincidence, but I hand this off to you now. What do you guys think about this case? Who do you think it could possibly be? I really have been, you know, believing it was Bobby Wayne Henry for years, but recently I have started leaning towards the fact that it could actually be a woman, and I'm starting to kind of believe that entirely now. The more I watch the video, the more I pay attention to this case, the more I kind of get into the details of it, I think it was a woman, and I think it was a woman who knew Missy. And that's pretty much all I have right now. But do you guys have anything else? What do you think? Who do you think it could be? As always, let me know in the comment section. As always, share this video if you think it was worth sharing. Like this video if you liked it. And make sure to subscribe if you're not yet subscribed and you like what we do here. I try to post at least a couple of videos a week to keep you guys entertained during this ongoing year of quarantine. Remember to follow me on Instagram and Twitter. Links are in the description box. Remember to check also and make sure you're still subscribed if you were subscribed before, because YouTube unsubscribes people from my channel all the time. They're just pranksters. They're always jumping out of closets and spraying me in the face with whipped cream, or, you know, just trying to destroy my channel. It's fun. Thank you guys so much for being here. As always, thank you to my Patreons. I also want to give a shout out to somebody else. I like to drop in on different YouTubers' lives all the time and kind of, you know, maybe donate a super chat here or there, just put my input in here or there, because as far as I'm concerned, YouTubers, they're like my coworkers, and I'd like to show my support by showing up at their lives and kind of watching. And there's certain YouTubers that I really enjoy listening to, and this channel called Tea Time, they went live last night. And I was just, you know, scooping my Neapolitan ice cream for the night, because I always have like a couple scoops of Neapolitan ice cream at night, and then I pour chocolate milk over the ice cream and it kind of freezes into this crystally like crust. It's so good. But I was doing that while I was listening to them in my earbuds, and you know, I just dropped in to say hi, and then I looked at my screen and one of their moderators, whose name on YouTube is Ms. Tonisha G, she said she loves me, she's been watching me for a while, and you know, she was just excited to see me there. So I do want to shout her out, because it's just so cool to like kind of go into other areas of YouTube and find people that, you know, watch you too. And it's like a small world after all, and I like it. Like, YouTubers are my coworkers. So it was definitely cool to see her and others there and just kind of drop in and be able to chat for a little bit before I passed out after I ate my ice cream. That's what happens. I eat too much ice cream and then I get tired and I pass out. But thank you guys so much for being here. Stay kind, stay beautiful, stay spooky, and I will see you very, very soon. Straight down, and that river runs deep, the mountains get steep, and the voice is getting too loud. All these feelings I've buried is looking like
grave, calling out my name. Better say a Hail Mary. Well, you don't know how deep it goes until it's getting you slowly. It's all you got to let it go. I got blood.